So, would like to request anyone, maybe somebody new again, or rather, if you haven't prayed in a while, to please lead in prayer this morning. Anita, is it possible for you to lead?
Yes, Pastor.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Father God, we praise you. We worship you, Lord, this morning. We come under your grace, Father. We ask you to bless each one of us, Father. Thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for Pastor Nancy, Father. Such a blessing she is for us, Father, as she is teaching us the word, Father. Help us to understand that word. Help us to understand your will, Father, in our lives, Father. Help us to pray, Father. According to your will, Father, help us to make a disciplined real life in our life, Father. I would like to give each one of us into your hand, Father. Holy Spirit, guide us, help us, and bless us, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. Thank you. Thank you, Anita, for leading us. And we trust that God will minister to each one of our hearts as we look at the subject that He has for us today. In the last three sessions, we spent time only on fasting and learned about how we can have this discipline and do it in a way that honors God. And in the last class, we saw how God chooses to bless us abundantly when we fast and we seek Him with fasting. So today we will go to chapter 20 in our notes, which is about small group and corporate prayer. So far, we have mainly been talking about individual who is engaging in prayer. Okay. And we said how as individuals we can pray for our family, we can pray for our church, we can pray for the city, now we can intercede, okay, for the needs of people around us. Now, it is also possible for us to gather in groups, or corporate simply means coming together as a church, or you know, in large numbers to pray and intercede. So it could be as a church, or it could be a couple of churches coming together. So we use the term corporate for that. Okay. So we can pray and intercede in teams, or more than one person can do that. Now, what is the value of getting together with people in prayer? Matthew chapter 18, verses 18 through 20. Can somebody please turn to that passage? Matthew 18. Verses 18 through 20, and read it, please.
Matthew chapter 18, verse 18 to 20. I tell you the truth, whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. I also tell you this, if two of you agree here on earth concerning anything you ask, my Father in heaven will do it for you. For when two or three gather together as my followers, I am there among them.
Thank you. Thank you, Jeffina. So we see here that God is encouraging agreement in prayer. So He's talking about spiritual authority, isn't it? Bind on earth, loose. So basically, it's like allowing, disallowing, what is in the kingdom of God here in our lives. We have the authority to do that. Now, along with talking about the authority that we are being told that when we pray in agreement with how many people? Two of you. Okay, two of you. Just two people. Okay, any one other person in agreement with me, he's saying that your Father in heaven, that He will do it for us. So that is so powerful, isn't it? That if you have two people agree on something here, that the Father will do it for us. So, that's a way for us. So God wants us to get together in groups, in teams, and seek Him to pray and intercede. Now, when Jesus was here, He had 12 disciples and He wanted to send them for ministry. He decided to send them two by two. Okay, so he felt that, okay, if two people, as they go for ministry, they pray together, it will be powerful. Okay, let them go serve together. Now, later on, we see Jesus died, He was buried, He rose from the dead, and He ascended up into heaven. And He told His disciples that you must wait for the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Now, when you observe, you know, in what manner these early believers, they were waiting for the baptism in the Holy Spirit, gathered together in prayer. Okay, so they were gathered in a place called the upper room. And what were they doing? They were praying. So was it immediately that the Holy Spirit was poured out of them? Do we know that that wasn't the case? Because during Passover, Jesus died. Okay. Before that, He had told them that, you know, before that He had breathed on them and, you know, He had was it before? No, after actually, after the Passover, after His resurrection, He breathes on them. And then later on, much later, just before He's ascended, He tells them that you shall receive the Holy Spirit and you shall be My witnesses. But I want you to wait. I want you to tarry. One of the practices of the church, the common practices of the people of God at that time, we can observe that they would pray together. So it was nearly, 50 days, because after the Passover till Pentecost, 50 days. Okay, so people waited that long for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. But when they are waiting for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, they don't know that God is going to do it on the day of Pentecost. They never even knew it. But God was getting ready to do that. But one of the practices which we observe is they were gathering together in prayer. They were praying together. The scriptures tell us in one accord in Acts chapter 2. They were in one accord, they had gathered together in prayer. So they knew the value of praying together. You know, as a family of God, as a people of God. And that is something that we must really learn from the early church. Even when the Holy Spirit was poured out, you know, these people were praying together. So 120 of them in one accord. Remember, we read Matthew 18. And what did that say? Any two of you agree touching one thing, it will be done for you by My Father in heaven. So, one is to have another person with us in prayer. But in addition to that, the emphasis is on agreement. Okay? If there is agreement, when we look at the people who had gathered in the upper room, the term used there for agreement is one accord. So they were in agreement for God to do what He had promised, and then it happened. Right, the rushing mighty wind, the Spirit came like a rushing mighty wind. Tongues of fire, you know, sat on each person, and they began to speak in tongues. So, gathering together is one thing. Being in agreement is another very important thing when we talk about group prayer. Okay, did the early church stop there? No, we have other instances of them praying together. So how about we read, you know, some of these verses? I think that will be very helpful for us. I'll just quickly tell us which passage to turn to. Okay, could somebody please read Acts chapter 2 and verse 1, please? Acts 2, verse 1.
Acts chapter 2.
Go ahead.
Anyone? Yeah.
On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place.
Okay. meeting together. Which version is that?
New Living Translation.
Okay, I think they have omitted the one accord. Yeah. Okay, no worries, no worries. How about, are you able to read from NKJV, Jafina?
No, ma'am.
Okay, you don't have that. All right. Okay, no problem. Anyone else?
Can I read?
Ah, yes, sure. Go ahead.
Okay. Acts chapter 2 verse 1, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place.
Okay, thank you, Divya. So this is NKJV. See what happens, no? In some of the translations, like your Message translation, and I think even the one New Living Translation, they paraphrase sometimes. Paraphrase means some of the words are missed out, but the meaning comes through. Like, you know, if you read the Passion Translation recently, you know, people like that translation because that language is very close to our hearts and very poetic. But it's not like a word-to-word translation. It's paraphrased. We say paraphrased, meaning the essence of it comes through, but some words are missed out. Important words. So whenever we are wanting to study God's word, a good thing to do would be to go to translations like NKJV. These are some of the older ones where you have, like, you know, it brings out the words as well as the essence of what is being said. Okay, so just a pointer there. You could also look at, you know, the Amplified Version, KJV, because they don't miss out the words. And then of course you can always compare it with the Hebrew language, the Greek language, to get the exact meaning. Okay, but we do use paraphrased versions, you know, like the one that Jeffina read, or the Message or Passion. Sometimes it's nice to read and understand the core meaning of what that person was trying to say. Okay, so in an easier language. So just a thought there. All right. So in the NKJV version, we saw that the term one accord has been given to us. Okay. So one accord is agreement. Now let's see. Let's go to Acts chapter 4. Okay. And could somebody please read from verse 23 to verse 31? 23 to 31, Acts 4. Slightly longish passage. Yes, please go ahead.
Acts chapter 4, verses 23. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that chief priests and elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, you made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the people plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers gather together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius and Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city of conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servant to speak your words with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform miraculous signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke with the word of godly bold.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sitkenu. So, you know, this is the passage where Peter and John, they were caught for a miracle that was performed, a lame man. Who couldn't walk from birth, the authorities, they catch Peter and John because they get scared. Oh, these people are the followers of that Jesus whom we crucified recently. Now, what will happen if these people continue speaking in the name of the same Jesus? We have had great commotion in the city. We don't want it again. So they catch them, they warn them. And the Peter and John, they kind of justify it. They say, look, a miracle has taken place. Why are you trying to blame us? So they warn them and they say, okay, they don't do anything to Peter and John because it was a notable miracle. Okay, and people would have thought that the authorities are doing the wrong thing. So they don't do anything against Peter and John, but they just warn them and they say, okay, stop preaching in the name of Jesus. Now go back. Now, what do you expect, you know, when something like this happens to us? We've just been through a very, like a shaky time. The authorities caught us and now we are going back. We may just want to sit and wonder about what happened. But look at what Peter and John do. And it shows us about the practice of the early church. So they had a habit of praying together. Okay, so after something like this has taken place, we are told that, and being let go, verse 23, they went to their own companions and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. So when they heard that, they raised their voice to God with one accord and said, so what are the people doing? They are praying together. So that is their habit. They have come out of a challenging time. But what is the practice of the church? They came to know, oh, we are under threat now. We have to pray. And they start crying out to God. You know, they say, God, you know, these people, they ill-treated Jesus. And now they're trying to stop us. But help us, Lord, to have boldness. It just shows the kind of dependence that they had. And it is, again, one accord. They all have the same heart before God. Which is saying, okay, God, we don't want to get scared of what is going on, but we want to have more boldness to do your work. So what is their prayer request? Their prayer request after the threat is, give us more boldness. Okay. And in the one part, they're all asking God to do this. And what is the result of that? You know, there is also, seems like a natural manifestation of the presence of God. They prayed, verse 31, it says, the place where they were shaken. So there also seems to be a natural, kind of a manifestation where the place was shaken. So they understood that, you know, God was involved in this, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and they spoke the word of God with boldness. So they got the answer to their prayer. It shows us how that a prayer of one accord was a common practice in the early church. And that is something, no matter what we go through, you know, when they were waiting for the Holy Spirit, they were praying together. When they were threatened, they are praying together. But how beautiful, right? That corporate small group prayer of agreement that the early church had. And that is something we have to understand the value of it. Now let's read one more passage. This is in Acts chapter 12. Okay, so I will narrate it for you so that you don't have to read the whole thing. One portion you could read. Okay, so basically what is happening here is you have one second. Okay. Yeah, so basically what's happening here is Herod, who was the ruler at that time, he, for political reasons, he knows that the body of believers is thriving, so he kills the leader, one of the leaders, James, the brother of John, is murdered. Then he finds that the people are very happy with him for doing this. So he wanted more favor from the people. So then he decides, okay, how about I seize Peter also and we'll kill him. But when he gets a hold of Peter, you know, that time was not the right time. It was a season, days of unleavened bread. So he could not immediately try Peter and kill him. So he just kept Peter in the prison and thought, okay, once this is over, then I will kill Peter also. So Peter is in the prison. Okay, Peter is in the prison. And it is a great time of fear that has come upon the church, because one of the leaders was just killed and another leader is in custody now with the intention of the government. You know, they know they also want to kill Peter. So how did they react and respond to what was going on? We see in Acts chapter 12 and verse 5, it says, Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. So that is the response of the early church. They knew that together they must pray in by waiting for the Holy Spirit, they are praying. You know, threatening Peter and John, they are praying. Now again, Peter is in the prison. What is their common practice? They only know to cry out to God. So constant prayer was being offered to God for him by the church. And what is the result of that? You know, later we see that, you know, that by in the night when Peter was sleeping, verse 7, now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison, and he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise quickly, and his chains fell off his hands. So when the church prayed, Peter was delivered supernaturally from the prison. God sent an angel to do that. So what is the result of group prayer, corporate prayer, prayer of faith? Okay. God intervenes, and God intervened supernaturally to set Peter free from the situation. And later, you know, Peter comes out of the prison in the night. He thinks he's dreaming, but only later he realizes that the angel led him, you know, out of that place. And he comes to, the angel leads him to a particular home. And when he comes there, this is from verse 12. Verse 12. I only read it for us. So verse 12 says, so when he had considered this, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying. So late into the night, how did Peter experience this breakthrough in his life? Constant prayer was being offered by the church, and even after he's delivered, the angel leads him to a house where what is going on? Many were gathered together praying late into the night. So, you know, they understood the power of praying together. You know, when the church prays together, when people of God pray together, what has just happened? Because of them praying, God sent an angel. The chains came off of Peter. Supernatural, miraculous deliverance has taken place. So, you know, all this, you know, I'm trying to share it for us to understand the power of God, you know, how God works in amazing ways when we pray together. And this is something that, you know, we must remember, and we can apply it in our own lives. So I'll talk a little more about it, but I want to show you one more quick thing. This is in, yeah, Acts chapter 14. Okay, Acts chapter 14, verse 20. So what happened is, Paul was on his first missionary journey. He goes to a place called Lystra. Initially, one miracle takes place. So everybody's happy. Paul and Barnabas, wow, they are like gods and all, something and all they say. But later, no, they also experience opposition. know, from the crowd. So at that point, they are so upset with Paul and Barnabas that Paul, they start stoning him. And in verse 19 of Acts 14, it says, then Jews from Antioch and Iconium came there, and having persuaded the multitudes, they stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing him to be dead. So what has happened? Paul has been beaten up, like, or rather he has been injured very badly, such that he was dead. Now, was he really dead or seriously injured? We don't know clearly from what is given here. What is the next thing that happens? Verse 20, however, when the disciples gathered around him, he rose up and went into the city. That's all we are told. Why did the disciples gather around him, an injured man? You know, it is likely that the disciples prayed over Paul, who was badly beaten up. And according to the Jewish, the way things happened in those times, it's only when somebody was dead that they would kind of, you know, drag them and treat them like this. So it is possible that Paul could have died also. We don't know whether he rose from the dead or whether he was healed from serious injuries. We're not clear. But either way, the disciples gathering around Paul shows us that they prayed for him. And what is the next thing you read? He rose up and went into the city. So simple. In a very simple way, it says they gathered, disciples gathered around him. He rose up, went into the city. And the next day he departed with Barnabas to Derbe. So there is power when people, believers, pray together. That's the point I'm trying to make with all these examples. And the early church knew it, you know, the prayer of agreement, people coming together and praying together. And did you see so many wonderful miracles, supernatural things are taking place as people are praying together. So whether we are going through a good time or whether we are going through a hard time, we saw just now a lot of persecution early church is going through, but it is a praying church. Even at the time of persecution, what did they know to do? Constant prayer was being offered. You know, when Peter came back, they were still in prayer. So they knew how to pray. And when there is a praying church, we will start to see a lot of God's supernatural intervention. So God answers and God works when the body of believers engages in prayer. And this is a way in which we can exercise our authority through the prayers that we pray. So we have to encourage, you know, praying together as far as possible. Now, it may not be a practical thing for us to pray to, you know, the entire church to pray, come together and pray, to organize something like that. It may be challenging, but wherever possible. So here at APC, every Sunday, we have the pre-service prayer time in all our locations. I think at Central, we've still not restarted that, but we have that. So at Central, I think there is a prayer time during the service. But you know, wherever we have the opportunity, it's good to have something like, you know, praying together. And not just at the service, but these prayer sessions can happen at other times. You know, here we also encourage small groups. So we have life groups. So in a life group, people can pray over matters, pray for each other, pray in agreement, pray for healing, pray for deliverance, pray for provision. So the prayer of agreement, right? The prayer of agreement is what makes the difference. The prayer of agreement is what releases the authority of God. And that is something that we can practice. Now, not just that, even two people, when there is anything that one wants to pray for, if you have even one person, maybe a brother in Christ, generally we say this, you know, it's good for women to pray with women and men to pray with men. So you connect with somebody, okay, who can agree with you. So I might call a sister and say, hey, you know, this is, I'm going through this. Can you agree with me based on God's word? You know, I want to see healing. Can you pray together with me? Let's agree together and let's pray. So we are going by what God's word has spoken, that there is power in our agreement, and then God is able to do it for us. So in whichever setting it's possible, you know, it's good to practice praying together. And prayer plays a key role, even prayer of unity also. Now, is it possible that people can come together but have no agreement? Yeah. So if that happens, then our prayers are not effective. So it is good to maintain that agreement on the matters. Then in one accord, when a set of people pray, that becomes very useful. Now, what if, you know, people don't know? People are gathered together for prayer and they don't know, you know, what points to pray for. So in order to bring clarity, in order to have some direction and focus for the group, it is a good practice to have some prayer points. So those of us who are leading group prayers, what we can do is you can have a you know, set of points and say, okay, first point, let us all pray for, let us pray for our city, let us pray for revival in the city. And then maybe you quote one or two scriptures where God's word says, I will revive you again. In Acts 2, God said, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. So, you know, when you direct the people to a particular point, what happens? Now everyone starts praying into that. So what are the people praying for? They are praying for revival. They are praying for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So maybe two or three people can pray just for that one point and everybody agrees. When we say amen, what is that? They're agreeing, okay, God, you know, let it be done in our midst. Now the prayer leader could say something like, okay, now let us pray for the government in our city. Okay, pray that God will appoint good leaders. Let us pray that God will bless them with wisdom. Let us pray for protection over the lives of our government officials. So then everyone can agree. Okay, we are praying for this point. Scriptures say that we must pray for all authorities. You know? So then you can also put in, you know, a couple of scriptures. That is helpful for the people. They understand, oh, this is what the Bible says. Okay, come on, let's all pray for our government leaders. So when people gather together, in a practical sense, it is helpful to have some points and, you know, some scriptures, because then it will guide everyone to focus in to that particular point and pray. Okay, so that's the way we can do it. So we can bring about that one accord in prayer. Now I know that in maybe something like our own church, people who have been in church for a while, we understand things in a similar way. Okay, so when somebody says pray for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, we understand it based on the way we have been taught in our church, so we pray in line with that. But if it is a gathering of people from different churches, everybody's understanding might be slightly different about the same matter. Okay, however, depending on the crowd, if you are the prayer leader, then you must understand, okay, this is the crowd, all right. So then you make the prayer point clear enough and you direct the people. So whatever everyone understands to that extent, whatever everyone agrees to that extent, people can pray together. Okay, so that is how a small group prayer can be conducted very well. Now in general, the scriptures say that as believers, we must have one, we should be of one mind, 1 Corinthians 1:10. So especially in a local church setting, you know, because we have the same vision, we have the same teaching and all of that, it is so helpful if we all have that one mindset and we pray together. Like the early church, you know, we'll be very, very effective and we will see God's power being manifested in our midst. So, you know, that's a little bit about praying in small groups and praying corporately together in prayer. There is a publication by the name of Revivals, Visitations and Moves of God. This is also a course. I think it is in our second year. So you will be studying about many revivals and how, when we look at what started that revival, you will be able to see that it was group prayer like this, okay, that actually started the revival. So there are a lot of examples of group prayers out of which, you know, God birthed a revival in Christian history. So that is the power of praying together. Okay, so we must encourage small groups, corporate prayers, and as far as possible, you know, help these groups have a focus. How to help the group have a focus? I just shared with you. Have clear prayer points. You know, don't bring in things which will cause confusion. Now, let's say there is a inter-church prayer meeting going on. So there are people from the Methodist church, people from the Baptist church, people from the Pentecostal church, people from independent churches. Now, when we are giving them prayers, let it be something that they can all agree on and pray, right? Like blessing upon the city. Okay, fine. Let's pray for that. Don't bring in, you know, confusion matters. So once people start arguing and getting upset with each other and disagreeing, the prayer will have no meaning over there. Okay, so prayer together, prayer in one accord, seeking God together, okay, in all matters, that is what brings the breakthrough of God. And as disciples of Jesus, like the early church, you know, we too have to practice this. And also, I just want to add over here that sometimes, you know, husbands and wives, because we saw how clearly in Matthew 18, you know, Jesus says, any two of you agree on one, touching one thing, then it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. So you see the power of two, even when husbands and wives, you know, they agree together, they pray together, that is, the kingdom of God will experience such mighty breakthrough. Just two people praying together. Okay, and that's how God wants it. We can incorporate this. We can, you know, trust God for breakthroughs as we pray in small groups or, you know, in our families, any two people or friends. I know of people who have friends whom they call every week or every morning and pray together, because there is power in the prayer of agreement. And of course, corporate prayer. Just a disclaimer here. We see the power of the prayer of agreement. Now, what if, you know, we don't have anybody we know and comfortable to share our prayer request? Will our prayer lack effectiveness? No. Okay. If you don't have the opportunity to team up with someone and pray about the matter, don't worry about it. Don't think that, no, this is not a prayer of agreement, so how can God answer it? See, God understands. You still haven't, let's say you've gone to another city or a country for your studies. You don't know anybody there. Nobody to agree with you in prayer. Don't worry about it. You pray. Okay, whatever opportunity you have, use that. If you're alone, pray alone, you will still get answers to prayer. But if you have the opportunity of praying with someone, then yes, agree with them and pray with them, and it is powerful. Okay, so yeah, any thoughts, any questions on this? Praying together or praying in small groups. Yes, Divya.
Thank you, Pastor. Yeah, this is an experience as well. Like during COVID time, in one of our Bible study groups, we had been doing like a prayer every day. So it'll have a format, and only one slide will change. That is the personal prayer needs. The others are like very generic. Like for the kids, we'll be praying, or for the city, we'll be praying. For pastors, we'll be praying. So in that case, after some time, now it is happening, but you know that how long it should go on. Like it sometimes it just dies down, right? After a while, So now I had been like since the Bible college is there, like we were not able to attend for quite some time. But what I was trying to say is with that, you know, the monotony of, you know, praying that same prayer points every day. So how do we just, you know, keep on going? From your experience, that's one thing. Another one, Pastor, is like there are certain groups where, I have been, you know, exposed to certain groups where the prayer points are just for the, you know, collecting your personal information, which is not which is not very comfortable. So we had to, you know, realize that and get out of such groups, because that really doesn't help us. So I was just, this two things just came to my mind when I was, you were telling this.
Yeah, thank you, Divya. Very practical, both issues. We encounter both of these, right? So even I am part of a prayer group, and I'm part of this prayer group for, I don't know, maybe in what, 6 years now? And as part of the prayer group, we had prayer every month, I think, and then it became every week. We have a prayer chain. It's on a WhatsApp group, so we every Friday, you know, we have this prayer slots that we all choose, and it's a chain prayer, so everyone gets to post their slots. Through the night we pray, even tonight we have it. And once a month we have a 24-hour prayer chain where people sign up. There are lots of people on the group, so they just sign up, they put their names. In the evening one, a prayer document is shared. Okay, and as what you said, no, Divya, some of the points are very generic. For a long time, we are, you know, pray for revival, pray for city. It's been there for years, we are praying. So how do we break the monotony of that? What I would say is ask God to burden us, because we know this is important. I can understand, you know, some matters like praying for the city, praying for revival, praying for our church. These are common prayer points, praying for our leaders. Almost, you know, every other day, these are the prayer points that we pray for. But when we are burdened for it, right, when we have a burden, and we know how Zechariah 12:10, it says the spirit of God is prayer of a spirit of supplication. Okay, so we can ask, Holy Spirit, burden me, you help me, you strengthen me to pray for these points. So when we have a burden for it, no, we will not think that it is monotonous. So ask God to make you passionate about it. So that's what I would do. And the second thing is, pray in spite of your feelings. So let me be very honest. There were some days, part of the prayer chain, you know, we sign up late night, early morning. So there are times when I'm so tired, even when I go into prayer with those prayer points. But pray in spite of your feelings. Yeah, we want to feel all passionate and charged up to pray. But even at times where your feelings are kind of giving up on you, you still pray. Because what I'm doing, it's going to, you know, it has value for the kingdom. So let me pray. Sometimes I just switch into tongues. Because sometimes I'm so tired and exhausted, you know, in the middle of the night, maybe I've taken a late night prayer slot, I'm just not able to say the words, but I'll pray in tongues for that 1 hour. I'll just pray in tongues, look at the prayer points, lay my hands on it, you know, pray for different people, they are sick, this and that. Just pray in tongues. That's also something you can do. Okay. So you can see these are some common things you can do. And if you're part of the leadership, you can make it a little more exciting. Now, recently we started a Zoom call for that prayer group. So once a month we come on a Zoom calls and you get to see the people, then it's, you know, a little more exciting. So things like that, you just try to make it, if you're part of the planning group, you try to make it more exciting in simple ways. So that would be some things that I would suggest. And coming to your second question, it is very, you know, I mean, we must be careful about that. I know I didn't mention it when I was sharing, but it happens that group prayer, praying in twos, it becomes a matter of gossip. It becomes, you know, a matter of getting personal information, like what is going on in this person's life. So if you feel that way, that, hey, the motive of this prayer group or this person that I'm praying with, it's not right. Okay, we are really not engaging in that pure way of speaking to God, bringing our requests to God, praying in one accord. Then I think if you don't have the comfort, either you can try to bring correction. You can speak to your friend or say that, hey, you know, this has been happening. I don't think it's good, no? So you kind of try to talk and see if it can be changed. If cannot be changed, then yeah, opt out of the group.
Yeah, yeah, that's right, yeah. Thank you, Pastor.
Yeah, sure. Divya, it is, I know, that is a danger. Gossip is a danger. Like you share, so trust somebody and you tell them, hey, I'm going through this, let's pray in agreement. And you, next thing you come to know, 3-4 people also know what you're going through. It's terrible.
Yeah.
Yeah.
By God's grace, yeah, I'm like, some of those groups have, you know, stopped praying together.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. That's good. So this prayer group that I'm talking about, no, on which I am, we have some guidelines. And one of the guidelines is confidentiality. Like whatever we post on the group, it should not be shared with anyone, even your family members. Keep it to yourself. So only if you agree on all that, you join the group. It's like that. So yeah, if you're leading a group of people, you can also have some guidelines and tell them. I'm sure people will understand. Yeah, good questions, Divya. Very good questions. Anything else, everyone? Because this is common, no? Small group prayer, praying with somebody, praying as a church. Great. So, in that, like, if you don't have any more questions, I think we could just wrap it up with prayer. And I would really like to encourage us, you know, to see wherever possible. If you do have people, believing people, then get together with them and just have a time of prayer and you see God's power moving, okay, in our lives. So, I mean, I just want to just remind it of this. So I will share it. It may not sound very spiritual or anything, but I have a niece, okay? She's, at that time, she was somewhere around maybe 2.5 or something. And I really wanted her to know the power of prayer. So one day I was just asking her that, what do you want? So she had just come over to visit me, and while coming home, she had brought a lollipop that had fallen somewhere. So she's very upset about it. So she told me, I want that. I want it back. So I said, okay, can we pray about it? We'll ask Jesus to give back that lollipop. And it was really a test of faith for me also. I said, okay, come, let's agree. Let's pray for God to give you back that lollipop. So we prayed together, and you'll be amazed. Maybe in about an hour's time, she was just walking around, running around here and there, and it had fallen in a like, you know, near the gate, it had fallen down. So somehow she found it, she grabbed it, she came running, and she said, can you believe it? You know, we prayed for the lollipop and I got it. So, you know, the prayer of agreement. So these are all ways in which, like, even kids, you just agree with them. They will understand. Now, the thing is, if we have like family prayer. My niece is about 4 years old. First, if anyone says, okay, who will pray? She'll be like, I will pray. She'll be the first one to pray. So, you know, learning prayer of agreement. So just something simple over there. I just felt like sharing with all of us. So, yeah. Okay, we'll stop with that. Would like to request somebody to please pray, and we can close. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, yes, Sipkin, please go ahead.
Father, we come to the throne of grace. The time you have given us, Lord, whatever we have learned about the prayer and intercession, Lord, thank you for your classes, Lord. Thank you for all the time you have given us. Thank you for this day. Thank you for the teachers and all the students and the privilege you have given us, Lord. Whatever we are learning here in this APC Bible School, Lord, let it be added to our knowledge, and Lord, it should be practiced in our daily life. And should be, and this knowledge should be used for the kingdom expansion and your work, Lord. All glory be given to Lord. We humble ourselves in front of you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Sitkenu. Yeah, thank you, everyone. Thank you for connecting today. Yeah, God bless you. We have another month of classes to go. So, hopefully by next week, you'll have your marks for the first assignment. So those of you who haven't submitted yet, please make sure that you send in your assignment. And I would also like to post the questions for your last assignment, so you have sufficient time to submit it before we end the course for this semester. Okay, so just a piece of information there. God bless you. Have a great day. Have a wonderful weekend of worship. And I'll see you all again next week. Take care. Bye.